Next one, the public hearing. The Hadley Planning Board will conduct a public hearing Tuesday, July 7th, 2015, beginning at 7:15 in the Hadley Senior Center Meeting Room. Purpose of the hearing is to review the application of Five College Inc. for special permits, site plan approval, business use in aquifer zone, and erosion and control for a proposed approximately 138,000 square foot structure off North Maple Street. The proposed use is of the building to store library books. The proposed plans are available for review in a town clerk's office during normal business hours, published twice in the Gazette, June 22nd and 29th. And with that, we will turn it over to Mr. Darnold for presenting.
Let me turn this a little bit so that everyone can see. And again, this is a proposed library annex for the Five College.
Can you move these so that we can see the
part? I'm sorry, yes, sir.
Sorry.
Again, this is located on North Maple Street. This is North Maple Street. Rocky Hill Road is up in this location. And we're proposing to take the access off of North Maple Street and come in and then construct the building. It's located on approximately a 45-acre site. The site currently is an active farm, including woods, wetlands, vernal pools, and a portion of the site is also considered rare habitat under natural heritage scenario. The northwestern portion is also partly under Zone 2 for the municipal water supply for the town of Hadley. The purpose, again, of the project is to provide shelving to supplement the capacities of the college's libraries. And the facility will ultimately serve the five colleges of Smith, Amherst, Hampshire, UMass, and Mount Holyoke. The facility will consist of a 2.5-story, 45-foot tall climate control building. Start over slow. 2.5-story, 35-foot high climate control building. And it's actually going to be consisting of five modules. Currently, we're proposing to construct just the first one, but we do understand we want to permit the entire site. We don't want to piecemeal that and come back and change scenarios for you.
Could you speak up a little louder, please?
Okay, I certainly will. Each one of the modules will be about 125 feet wide and 260 feet deep. Again, with the all the modules constructed, it'll be about 625. All the five modules constructed. 125 by 260. Okay. No?
206.
Yeah, you said that. I think you said.
Yeah. Again, so it would be about 625 feet long, about 200 feet deep. And included with that is essentially an academic area, which is about 8,822 square feet, about 24 feet high, 55 feet by 165 feet. So that will be essentially the academic area.
What do you mean by academic area?
This is where the offices were. There'll be some meeting rooms that are associated, bathrooms, et cetera.
There'll be any lecture halls or seminar halls?
Many lecture hall, correct. Proposal is when they're up and running, there would be staffed at approximately 12 full-time employees. There'll be a messenger van coming in probably typically twice a day, once in the morning, once in the afternoon. They'll pick up or drop off books. There may be occasions where there may be a maximum of approximately 30 people on site at any particular one time. Their hours of operation right now are tentatively scheduled between like 7:30 in the morning to about 6 o'clock in the evening during the weekdays, with occasional weekend use. The project proposes to access, again, off of North Maple Street through a 20-foot wide paved access drive, which would come down and enter here. There's approximately 30 parking spaces, which would
accommodate the actual use of this particular structure. The site will also have a gravel fire lane around the entire structure, which will allow 360-degree access for fire apparatus to totally circumnavigate the building for fire protection.
But it will be a sprinkler building, right?
It will be a sprinkler building, correct.
Paper books?
Pardon?
On paper books? A sprinkler building?
By law.
By law. We did examine trying to gain access through Rocky Hill Road. Several reasons we didn't do that was quite a few reasons. There's a very steep access up in this location. The site distance here is not nearly as good. And also, I mentioned before, this is endangered species. Natural Heritage has classified that. And
what's the endangered species?
Spadefoot toad.
Spadefoot toad.
And there's the soil classification changes. This type of soil, and I'm not a endangered species person, my understanding that this particular type of soil is conducive to the burrowing spadefoot toad. The area over here is less conducive to that, so this is more of a prime area for the endangered species. That's another reason that we decided not to provide the access road off of...
We can't hear you very well, so okay. Sorry.
Decided not to take the access off of North Rocky Hill Road because of dangerous species, the steepness of the grade, with reasons that, and the site distance here was not as good as it was off of North Valley Street. Plus, we would be introducing additional traffic, although it's very limited traffic. We'd be introducing more traffic in more of the residential type area rather than off of North Maple Street, which serves the industrial area to the east.
How close is the nearest residence to that proposed site?
We're about 1,000 feet from here to here. The nearest resident would be from here. I can grab a scale, but I'm going to guess that's probably around 600 feet, 700 feet.
And we're about, we know where our homes are. We're telling
you
where we live.
Why don't you tell us where the address is on there?
So you're going to put Yankee Candle in our back.
Whoa, whoa, people, whoa, people, wait.
Oh, I thought he invited
No, no. Okay. It's not open to general questions. The planning board will get your chance.
Oh, okay.
Okay, you will get your chance to speak. Okay, but this is not a free-for-all because we've got to keep control of the meeting. Okay, no offense to anybody. Okay.
My mistake, sorry.
No, that's okay.
I just want a little give and take here, Jimmy.
A little is okay. We quickly could lose it.
There will be time for that.
Yes, it will.
In due course.
Yeah, the site will be served by municipal water. There's a municipal water main in North Maple Street. We'll propose to bring in adequate water to the site to give us adequate fire protection.
Size?
I believe it's I think we have a 10-inch there because of the distance. We did a fire flow. No, we had to bring in an 8 because we did a fire flow test and we can't increase the size of the water main. I believe we have an 8-inch line coming in. As shown in the plans, I can give you a better, it's only the plans that we submitted to you. It's either 8 or 10.
Because of the sprinklers.
Correct, right. So we brought in a water main to come here. It actually serves the building for fire suppression as well. We have a loop system coming around the building to provide hydrants at spacing around the building as well, should that be needed. Sewer from the pipe, we have to, because it is down in the gradient, we're proposing to take the sewer and put it through a small ejector pump. Again, this is a small sewage generator, primarily just two bathrooms. Small ejector pump, which we'd have a force main, which would pump it up the roadway into a manhole near the roadway. We don't like typically to put a force main into the municipal system, so we would terminate it at a standard sewer manhole near the roadway, and from there it would gravity into the city's, the town's municipal sewer system.
How far away is that going to be from the sewer line?
Pardon?
How far is that drop going to be away from the sewer line? Because I know in sewers where we put pressure to them, it forms the gas and it ruins the pipeline. So I want to know how far back
our terminal manhole is.
Right.
I believe we have like 20 feet from the roadway.
I think there's going to be a problem with that.
Yeah. And again, we would be very willing to work with the sewer commission if they would like to modify the exact location of that terminal manhole. And we'd be glad to take the sewer man, pressure pipe all the way to the sewer line in the roadway, but typically, my experience is we like to bring it back and give the city a gravity line. The soils throughout the site are relatively poor from a drainage perspective, slow to percolate, and with a relatively high groundwater. It's sort of a two-edged sword in that scenario. It's having the high groundwater and poorly draining soils makes it a little more difficult from an engineering perspective to address the drainage. However, it's also on a beneficial side because they are poor soils and poor drainage. The existing runoff from the site is really high because rain falls on it, poorly drained soils. We have a lot of rain runoff. So by adding the development, it does increase the runoff from the site, but not significantly. So it makes it a little bit easier to address the additional runoff. The drainage quality, there's two aspects that we address when we're doing drainage. One is drainage quality. The roadway, it's a sense we consider the roadways to have contained dirty water, basically. And what we're proposing to do is something a little different than what typically is done. We're calling what the LID, low impact development. Typically, in the past, we always collect all the drainage, send it to a single location, and treat it for both water quality and attenuation. In this particular situation, we're proposing to add rain gardens along the side of the road. A rain garden is essentially a small constructed basin filled with soil and plants, which will take a short section of roadway, take it off, let nature do its thing about collecting the water, treating it for temperature, sediments, and water quality. And we have a series of these based along the side of the road. And you'll notice they're all on the south side of the road. And the way we accomplish that is typically a road is crowned. So part of the water goes to one side, part goes to the other. We essentially tip the entire road, so the entire road drains from north to south, so we collect all the dirty water from the road and drop it off at strategic locations along here into what we call the rain gardens. It's sort of a current green thinking for treating the storm water. The other aspect of treating the water quality, not volume or anything else, is this parking area here. We didn't have the ability to send all of this to a rain garden, so we're putting them in more of what we call conventional stormwater treatment chambers. It's more of a fancy catch basin, which traps the water, traps all the sediments, and treats it to a high level of 80% TSS removal, trapped suspended solids. The roof, we consider that to be clean water. That's not dirty. Water falls on a clean roof. And so we are not treating the roof for water quality. That's one aspect of it. The other aspect that we need to treat is we want to make sure we don't cause any detrimental effects downgrading from our site. So we want to make sure that the drainage doesn't flood off-site or neighbors downgradient. The way we've done that is essentially the water's flowing from north to south. We had to put a culvert in here to let this water go through, and we sized the culvert to take some of the drainage from part of the roof and a part of the parking area, and it somewhat detains the water in this area, slows it down to make it not any worse than it was before construction. And we also have a very large detention basin here, which is essentially a small, shallow basin, which would take the roof water, hold it, and release it at a slow rate so it doesn't go any faster, doesn't cause any downstream flooding. The water's routed to what we call a level lip spreader. We take the water, sort of like a fish a horse trough. The water enters it, and we make sure it leaves at a very level area, low velocity, so we don't cause any erosion from the water coming out. We size this, check the velocity of the water coming out in a 100-year storm, and also check the type of soils to make sure there's not going to be creating any erosion. So we ensure that we don't cause downstream flooding, we don't cause erosion in that location. We do not address infiltration. A lot of times that's a third item of stormwater that we try to address. And because of the poor soils and high groundwater, we have to comply with not only the town of Hadley, but the state DEP requirements for stormwater management. When you have these particular type of soils, DEP does not require you to do recharge. They request that you do it to the maximum extent practicable. And we are obtaining a significant amount of recharge in each one of these rain gardens. They're going to be holding the water, so they will be recharging the water and decreasing the volume, but they're not under any particular tight criteria or guidelines that we're going to be supplying the recharge with. Another somewhat of a different aspect of this project which makes it a little bit unique, we do have water flowing from the north to the south, and there's several, there are no distinct streams, but there are definitely drainage areas and concentrated flows which come through at several locations. And so we want to make sure at each one of those locations, we checked it in the field and also based upon the survey maps that we did, wherever there was a concentrated flow coming through, we put in a culvert. So water coming through just continues going. We didn't stop it. We didn't intercept it. We didn't bother it, other than making sure that it had the ability to pass through a site without modification. So we took that into account as well. One of the aspects for choosing the location of the building, we looked at multiple locations. We had the building all over the site from an engineering perspective, and also because of the natural heritage perspective, this area up in the northern portion was pretty much sacred. We had comments from natural heritage, so we wound up primarily having to put the building to the south side of the building of the site to protect the natural heritage area. And then we had to put the drainage on the south side of there too, because the water goes from north to south. We can't catch the water before we generate it. So that sort of dictated the building had to stay out of a natural heritage area. We had to collect the water before it left the site, so we had to leave room for detention. So the site sort of dictated our configuration that we have finally come up with. One of the things specifically addressing the board here is parking. We are under the Dover Amendment. I think, Bill, you could probably expand on that later on in the hearing. But parking, typically, and the regulations in town of Hadley stipulate that you need to provide parking to accommodate your site, whatever you're doing, and we've done that. But in addition to that, it requires you to have twice the parking area as you have for building. Not that you have to build it, but you just have to show that I can fit it on the site. And based upon this site, that's relatively an easy type of thing to do. We can physically fit it on the site, accomplish that, still have adequate open space, setbacks, everything else that we need. However, when we showed that to Natural Heritage, they considered that reserve parking a take and said that they would not approve the project with the reserve parking in that location.
That's a problem.
Pardon?
That's a problem because our bylaws.
I figure that's going to be a major portion of our discussion.
Our parking is 2-for-1, and from what I understand, that's not exempt from the Dover.
We'll follow up. Phil and I have a letter.
Okay, so what does the site require under the bylaw?
The site will require under the bylaw twice the building area, which
276,000.
About, but yes, I think so.
A whole lot. Yeah. Is that's a single story building?
Correct. It's not two story. Yes. Okay.
So we don't have to. And you are proposing?
We have 30 parking spaces. I don't know if I have the actual square foot
area. It's 35 feet tall, you said. So that's going to be one.
It's 2.5 stories tall.
You said 2.5 stories tall, but it's only a single story. So we don't.
Single story inside, not two floors.
Okay. Correct.
Because of the stacks for the floors.
So we're way under that area. I don't have the exact numbers. I can get that to the board. And I figured that would be a point of discussion. I wanted to bring it up now and then summarize, just sort of summarize the project to get into a large scale, a small scale. This is just a little bit closer showing of the building and how it's laid out. We meet open space requirements. We meet stormwater requirements. We meet all setbacks. We're about 1,000 feet from the road, frontage areas. The frontage actually is 130 feet on Rocky Hill Road. We need 200, but it's an existing non-conforming scenario. We're not making it any more non-conforming. The width is also non-conforming. We don't have the width, but it's the existing non-conforming. And the heights requirements are met as well.
What's your frontage on Rocky Hill?
That's, it's 130.
What's your frontage on North Maple?
I think it's about 50.
Oh, really?
Okay. It's very narrow here. So that's a real quick summary. I'm sure we're going to have a lot of questions. I wanted to give you a quick overview. We can get into any of the details.
Business use in aquifer is pretty straightforward. What about the erosion control? What are you going to do during construction? There's an awful lot of construction going on for this.
Right. We have a whole set of erosion control plans. Again, this heavy black line you see here is erosion control is also a amphibian barrier. So we have to prevent amphibians from encroaching on our site and also prevent erosion from leaving our site. So we have to install that erosion control barrier all the way through, as well as all the rain guards. Again, the roadway is a 20-foot wide roadway. It's built mostly above grade. By the time we put that in, we don't see a lot of potential, and the water drainage coming through. We're going to install the drainage cross culvert, so this area is not really an issue. And by designing and constructing this first, anything that comes off the building site will have a temporary diversion.
Can you go back to the bigger drawing?
Sure.
So, all the, obviously the slope is downhill from here. Does it continue to be a downgrade from here? Like, where's the low spot before?
It continues going. Just not to get into details, but this is somewhat of a ridge. Right.
Okay.
Here. So any drainage from this point here continues going this way. So even though it's a big project, all this drainage, we really don't touch it.
Okay.
So, but the drainage from this area here does come through. Most of this is going to be going through cross culverts. We are collecting some of this here and detaining it.
About how far north or how far south is the nursing home from here, roughly?
That's...
There's a walk plan if you want one. And that's with the drainage and the wetlands.
Whoa, where are we now?
You're talking about this piece of property right here.
Right here.
And the senior center is right here.
Nursing, okay, so where you're
roughly. Right. Nursing room right there.
Right here. Okay, where you're right here. Okay. Okay, you can have that back.
All right.
Thank you.
Multiple copies.
Okay, so you're probably, a nursing home is about.
Yeah, I'm
going to say
it's
maybe
probably
here.
800 feet or so,
yeah,
I would guess.
Okay. They're trying to get a perspective, that's all. Okay. Yeah. Other board, questions on the board?
So just go over again the nearest structures.
Oh.
You said about 1,000 feet off North Maple?
Yes.
And Rocky Hill is about 600.
Yes, let's guess that.
And the nursing home is?
I would say 800.
Kind of southwest, southeast.
Southeast.
And High Meadow?
High Meadow? It's about 800, 850. To the cul-de-sac, I don't know about the closest structure.
That's your house.
That's my house,
800. It's a lot closer to the building, yeah. So that's not...
There's a building. Yeah. This is the property line. Around the closest building to the property line is about 640 feet. From this building to that property line is 640 feet.
Okay.
What are you going to do for sheer runoff when the ground froze in the wintertime?
Well, in the ground frozen in the wintertime, it does the same thing tomorrow as it does today. Other than the fact that now we have detention basins to slow it down. Before, there wasn't. So if you have complete runoff due to frozen ground today, it's going to be the same tomorrow.
Who's going to maintain all those basins?
The owners of the Five College.
They're going to maintain that road?
That's correct. It's a driveway, correct.
Is elevated enough so it acts like a dike from that water, only that you... put the basins in there, I mean the culverts?
Cross culverts, correct, yeah. In general, the road is in 2 to 3 feet above existing ground.
Does Five Cal or Jink have a maintenance department?
I'm going to have to request that...
I need a labor and executive director.
Answer that question.
No, we don't, maybe we'll hire appropriate service.
Who's the president of Five Cal or Jink? Is it Biddy Martin?
Biddy Martin is the president of the board of directors, chief operating officer.
She's the president, for those of you who don't know, she's the president of Amherst College.
Is there any elevations of these buildings?
There are some elevations that were contained in the original submission, and if you want to look through them, they're now, I didn't mount all 30 drawings here.
What is that, a block building?
Yeah, we want a picture of it too.
I think the original, towards the back. I have two sets of plans if you want another set.
They can load them here.
Yeah, so I might have to roll another one over.
I'm sure which ones to mount, so I mounted all 30 of them, so.
That's the building?
That's the building. Building elevation against rail plane. Because of function, it doesn't need windows. It's a climate-controlled building.
It's a warehouse.
Pardon?
It's a warehouse.
It's a warehouse.
That's really what it is. One loading dock is this location, so the vehicle would come in, back up, unload here in the, I'll call it the administrative area.
What is this, all stucco walls?
I don't have the...
Block walls, precast? What are they?
It's tilled-up concrete slabs.
It's, what is it?
Tilled-up concrete poured on site, the 38-foot-high, 4 feet go down.
This thing is about the ugliest thing I ever seen.
4 feet go down to the foundation wall.
It's terrible.
What color is it?
What color will it be?
Clear. The exact palette hasn't been selected, but in the gray-brown palette family.
We'd like to see what the color, we'd like to see a color drawing of what it looks like.
We can provide that.
Okay.
The design build contractor has that.
How about screening?
We had talked about putting screening on here. But what we have right now as a proposal is landscaping around the immediate, I keep calling it administrative area. We're not proposing at this point in time any other plantings. We've talked about putting plantings up here, but again, it needed to be in compliance with the natural heritage. They were very careful about what we could plant. So at this point in time, we don't have any screening for the building. Again, this is a wood line from wood lines, sort of difficult to see, but this is the edge of woods at this location here.
What's the elevation of Rocky Hill Road?
Rocky Hill?
Yeah. Do you know, roughly?
38 feet above it?
At least.
We look right down on top of it. I mean, we'd be looking right on the roof.
What's the elevation of Rocky Hill Road? Do you have a ballpark number?
Yeah, if I can go to the original survey plans.
If that's in a hole, what good is screening if everybody's going to look down at it?
Has this plan been approved by the board of directors?
It's 196.
Do they have authorized
us? They just knew you were going to come to Hadley and put this in someplace. They didn't. Is Biddy Martin aware of where it's going to get going?
Yes.
Say down and backwards. At 196 at North Maple.
Okay.
What plan is that one right there?
That's, what page is that, Joe?
That's five.
Sheet 5 of 5. Sheet.
C5, right?
C really hard.
Goes way up, way in front. This is a good one.
Yeah, this is Rocky Hill. I mean, this is North Maple.
North Maple, correct, with the houses here.
Correct.
And the building will be located approximately... so. Well, while we're addressing the looks of the building, certainly we're going to want to see a sketch of it. And from the point of view of giving an industrial look, even if you rely on the Dover Amendment, it doesn't necessarily mean you have the right to put any piece of something in somebody's backyard. We have made it a point, even on Route 9, we don't want to see a sea of blacktop with a wall of cement. For example, Staples was going to have a wall of cement. They put full windows in there. You can make it look better. You can jazz it up. Rather than relying on the Dover Amendment to say you can stick anything down our throat in a residential area. So, first of all, you've got to bring us what it's going to look like.
Well, I have a question whether or not it even comes on the Dover Amendment. Because the Dover Amendment says it has to be a primary or dominant purpose is education. And just because you're putting a seminar, quote, seminar hall, lecture hall in there, doesn't make necessarily make it an education building.
Let's take a little detour to discuss the Dover Amendment, what it is and what it isn't. The Dover Amendment, what's called the Dover Amendment, is one sentence that appears in the Zoning Act, which is Chapter 48 of the General Laws. Chapter 48, Section 3 says, no zoning ordinance or bylaw shall prohibit, regulate, or restrict the use of land or structures for religious purposes or for educational purposes on land owned or leased by the Commonwealth or any of its agencies, subdivisions, or by a religious sect or by a nonprofit educational corporation, provided, however, that such land or structures may be subject to reasonable regulations concerning the bulk and height of structures and determining yard sizes, lot area, setbacks, open space, parking, and building coverage requirements. So the genesis of this was the town of Dover did not want to let a private school build a dorm where the school wanted to build a dorm. The school had better friends on Beacon Hill than the town did. And hence we have the Dover Amendment, which is what we have to live with for now. The applicant did provide us with a package of information relating to their corporate status that I shared with Town Council. It is Town Council's opinion that the Five Colleges does satisfy the requirements of the Dover Amendment, and that this project satisfies the requirements of the Dover Amendment.
But that doesn't necessarily make it moral, does it, Bill?
It doesn't make it moral.
Thank you.
It makes it legal. There's a big difference.
There's a big difference,
The second point, I did receive a second letter from Five Colleges Council, who did say that regarding the parking, and we are allowed to subject it to reasonable regulations concerning parking. And they cited to some cases which have been decided by our appeals court and our Supreme Judicial Court, and they pretty much confirm that requiring them to put in 276,000 square feet of parking space would be unreasonable for the demand they have. There were some cases coming out of the Greater Boston area. Doesn't directly apply to us, but they were saying that they can't even require a school to accommodate all of its parking on site if there is on-street parking available. So, on that basis, the Dover Amendment does seem to apply to this project, and the and Town Council has also confirmed that the parking point they make is reasonable, and we certainly would never require you to pave 200,000 square feet if you only needed 10,000 square feet. But Town council seems to concur that we probably can't require them to set it aside as reserve parking.
Is that in writing, Bill?
It is not. If you would like me to ask him to put it in writing, I can.
Absolutely.
That was a half-hour telephone conversation after he had received the material submitted by Five Colleges attorney.
I think a project of this magnitude and where it sets, we need to have everything documented in writing before we make any kind of decision.
Okay. I will ask him to provide a written opinion.
Because an institution such as Five College Inc. says that this project is getting a waiver because of the Dover Amendment, does that mean that's the end of it?
No. No, we have subject to reasonable regulations. So we have to look at what we can address. Bulk and height of structures, yard sizes, lot area setbacks, open space, parking, and building coverage requirements. Of that list, it would appear that the bulk of the structure is the one thing we have.
But isn't the real issue whether this has a dominant educational purpose, a warehouse for books? Isn't that the issue?
No, it says on land owned by, use of land for educational purposes on land owned by an educational corporation.
Is a warehouse for books an educational purpose? That's my question.
I will repeat, town council has opined that they satisfy the Dover Amendment.
I'm not sure that that's a good opinion.
If someone wants to hire a lawyer to get a second opinion, we could talk about it. But
in 30 minutes, he came to his opinion as to what the Dover Amendment was.
That's why we have town council. He deals with this all the time.
Okay.
Copelman and Page is a specialist in municipal law. So I can certainly ask him to lay out his
reasoning
in more detail, but we certainly do have bulk and height of structures, yard sizes, lot area. Well, lot area is satisfied, setbacks are satisfied, open space is satisfied, parking and building coverage are not going to be an issue, but the bulk and the height of the structure certainly would. This is this is larger than Home Depot.
Yes.
It's the size of a Yankee candle.
It's about
the size of a Yankee candle.
Well, we're going to deal with local businesses.
Yes.
We have to deal with our environment. We can't compare it to
others. Home Depot was,
I did a comment on behalf of the planning board to the Secretary of Environmental Affairs when they filed an environmental notification form. They did receive a determination from the Secretary of Environmental Affairs that they did not have to file an environmental impact statement. Proposed structure at build-out has a footprint of 156,000 square feet. Home Depot is only 115,000 square feet. The bylaw subsequently was changed in a way that was intended to exclude future big box stores. Unfortunately, that was a petition article that was not well drafted. So it's a little unclear, but this is larger than anything that would be allowed in the business district at this time.
The largest building currently that would be allowed in a business district is 75,000 square feet, not quite 2 acres.
Okay, there's 43,000 roughly square feet, 43,000 square feet in an acre.
So this is about twice the size of the largest single building that would be allowed presently.
And but because, like Bill says, because the way the article was drafted when it was passed for the 75,000 square feet, it was a petition article, and it was amended a little bit on town meeting floor, but ultimately, this doesn't fall into the zone that limits the size. However, it's still big.
It does provide a model for a baseline for us. The other thing is that the petition article tried to do a distinction between retail space, because it was designed to deal with Walmart, and it handles non-retail space differently. So, and this clearly is non-retail space. So,
can it ever be zoned for business? Like, if they decide to sell it in the future?
Yes.
Yes. That's a problem. That's the problem we have to deal with once in a while on a structure like this. Like, let's say down the road, they decide they don't want this anymore. You now have 138,000 square foot structure in an ag residential zone that was designed for residential, that doesn't have adequate parking, that doesn't have a lot of adequate facilities, and what do you do with it? And it's also
in a residential area. It was supposed to be put into that area.
So let me go back to your question initially. Yes, it can be rezoned, but that requires a two-thirds vote from town meeting to do it. And it would be unlikely with the current voices in town, but anything can happen.
But I would hope we want to avoid that. So that if this happens, then it's an empty building, and it's
probably a long shot. However, you know, nothing is forever.
But we can limit it.
Yeah.
We can recommend that we limit the size based on.
We are not sure.
That seems to be the open line of questioning.
Yes.
Is this building we're looking at 12,000 square feet?
No.
Wait. Everybody, please. One question at a time. Let the chairman recognize you. Don't be asking questions of one to the next so that we can all get one voice. This meeting is by no means going to be done tonight. Okay? There will be no decision tonight. There is just way too many open issues, and it'll be continued. To when, we're not sure yet. But to say there'll be a decision tonight is probably not a reasonable thing to expect. So we will probably have a chance to speak again. We have questions. Bill has things to go back to town council. But we still want to keep, you know, one person at a time speaking, just so we can keep order and everybody can hear what's going on.
If I could just say one thing to a comment that was made earlier. If this were a commercial development, we would not even think of approving it without even knowing the color of it. Yeah. And that, I think, is that really is a pretty key. So until you can tell us exactly what color. We had someone come in once proposing tan vinyl siding, and they put up blue vinyl siding because apparently that was cheaper.
Bill, when you say we wouldn't prove it, you mean take a vote on whether
we wouldn't vote on anything without knowing.
Yeah. Well,
maybe that gentleman can reply.
So we do have a current color plan that we could provide.
Okay.
But if you have advice on what that might better be, for example, we the plan currently has a two-tone coloration of, you know, sort of the upper half or third is a different color than the bottom. But the question is, if you're saying you would like more variegation in that for windows or whatever, though that's in painting and could be done. So my question is there advice beyond the yes, no to whatever we propose? Is there advice about what would be viewed more appropriately.
We would like to see something that is not as stark, and maybe the plans don't do it justice, but some variations in design. It's hard to talk about it because you've seen the plans and we haven't.
No, I understand. I'm just asking for what characteristics.
But drive around town and...
In trees.
If John Devine was still here and alive, his comment would be, it does not look colonial.
Understood.
Okay.
Yep.
It looks Stalinist.
Yeah, right. The driveway. Cross sections similar to a subdivision road? Amount of compacted gravel, how much?
Yeah, the we had OTO do borings on some line of road, came up with a geotechnical report suggesting the driveway, with the realization that the driveway was going to be used for light vehicular traffic and occasional panel van, but it would be used for construction vehicles. So it's designed to accommodate H20, which is a fully loaded vehicle. And the cross-section is 4 inches of pavement, I think 4 inches of gravel and 8 inches, 4 inches of heavy gravel and 8 inches of regular gravel, so.
16 inches.
16
compacted. And there's clay there, so you're going to have to put the fabric in?
Right. The another reason he did the boring throughout the area, there's an extremely amount, a large amount of topsoil there, so the requirement to remove the topsoil was also... concerned, so.
Well, if this were any other kind of building subdivision, we would ask for two exits. We always do in a subdivision. If, for example, something happened, a fire truck couldn't make it there, how would you get the fire truck down there? So I'm going to request another exit onto Rocky Hill Road just for fire safety.
I would say that we don't have a need to assure fire safety. They're assuming the risk. It's their problem, and I don't think I want to see an exit on Rocky Hill.
Why do we require it in a subdivision?
Because there are people there, there are houses. This is one structure owned by one business. If they...
What if the fire truck can't get there?
They have a sprinkler.
But there's going to be students in the lecture hall, in the supposedly, one of the students has an emergency, the ability for the
heavy fire truck to get in there, it's going to happen.
Again, I personally didn't talk to, I know the fire department has been consulted regarding the use of gravel for the emergency access around the building. I assume that the planning board distributed plans to the fire department for comments. And I don't know if we received any comments from the fire department.
Yeah, you can put your hands down. We'll announce when it's the public section. We're going to get board comments out first.
The planning board the comments first.
No.
Well, the other suggestion regarding Rocky Hill Road came from the Conservation Commission to ditch the exit here because there's too much interfering with wetlands and Rocky Hill Road. So that has not been resolved totally yet, has it?
Right. The one thing I didn't bring up on the presentation, this project obviously is under scrutiny of the Conservation Commission, DEP, because we are involved with wetlands, working in buffer zones around vernal pools. And one of the criteria when you do a wetland filing is to submit what they call an alternative analysis to see if there's other alternatives to decrease the impact. We have a written alternative analysis, which discusses access, and where is the building located? Is it located the best place for least environmental impact? And also the access to both driveways, and again, natural heritage is a driving factor as to why we didn't go to the west in Rocky Hill versus to the east, to North Maple Street. So that's a requirement from the Wetland Protection Act that we have to satisfy the Conservation Commission that the alternative analysis that this is the correct and appropriate access for the site.
The frontage on North Maple Street is how much?
I believe it's 50 feet.
50 feet?
Correct.
Rocky Hill Road frontage?
120, I believe, yes. And again, by looking at the contour line, you see it's extremely steep grade going from Rocky Hill down to the site.
Okay.
we'd like to keep it at a reasonable rate for both the users and also as for emergency vehicles as well. We don't want to have a too steep a grade to exit or enter the site.
Who's going to be in charge of security and fire protection for that building?
Again, I can't speak for Fire College, but I think it's no different than any other privately owned or publicly owned, facility. Again, it's going to be security lighting on the building.
Taxpayers are going to pay for it.
Pardon?
Taxpayers are going to pay for it then.
I mean, as far as police protection?
Police protection and ambulance and everything, that comes under the tab of the town.
Well, yes, the thing, sir. Mark, you're feeling a little bit of the venting, especially from the planning board. For example, the University of Massachusetts is supposed to come before us as you're coming before us. They did not come before us for a $34.5 million addition to the stadium, McGurk Stadium, nor did they come before us for the basketball practice facility, and both of those are in Hadley. The idea that the Dover Amendment is making them so cavalier they can overrun the town,
yep,
people, neighbors, it kind of leaves a little bit of a sour taste. Yet, nevertheless, we do realize that this is the nuclear engine for our economy. So, you know, we can't poo-poo it too much. But nevertheless, just because they are the big dog, they shouldn't necessarily act like it all the time.
Yes, we got some comments back there.
So I wanted to respond to two of the questions. Our discussions with Natural Heritage about the frontage and access on Rocky Hill Road has opened the question of whether we may manage the plant growth on an access path from Rocky Hill Road for the sole purpose of allowing emergency access, that because it would be on the habitat that they care about, that needs their approval, as we discuss conservation management plans and conservation restrictions for 35 acres of the northern and western part of the property. But we have requested their consideration of allowing us to prune and leave open a route from Rocky Hill solely for the purpose of emergency vehicle access. But that would simply mean keeping the growth on that.
So this is one of those catch-22s where two agencies in the Department of Environmental Protection are arguing over, one says don't come on my space, one says don't come on my space.
Exactly.
It's part of the wonder that is a land use planning in Massachusetts.
Anything else on the board?
Well, I kind of agree with Joe with the two roads in there. And not a gravel road, because if there's an emergency, you're not sending a truck down in a big fire truck that weighs mucho tons to go down a dirt road, whether there's a gate on it on Rocky Hill, so there's no traffic other than emergency vehicle in there. You just...
Then you'd have to drive over that special land.
Yeah. But the cross-section of the road that you're putting in off of North Maple Street, the one that's proposed here on page 5, seems to be up to an industrial state standard.
Correct.
With the, and the width, I didn't catch the width.
It's a 20-foot width.
20-foot width.
Yeah. Two cars can't pass.
And certainly you want a letter from the fire chief, because we want to see if the...
Anything else on the board before we ask
well,
you to come
the sewer, thing? John, are you satisfied with the sewer, the ejector pumps and all
no,
of that? Who's
no,
maintaining
it? I just think that's that sewer... Because I had experience when I was sewer commission, where our pump stations dump, and they form a gas and they chew that pipe all up. So if that thing was set way back, if that's possible, and gravity flow, the further back on their property they can set that, and then it'd be their problem, not the town's problem.
Who owns the ejector pump and who's responsible for that?
Well, the applicant owns the ejector pump.
It's all elevation.
John's talking about the manhole and the ejector pump that comes in.
It's all elevation.
Yeah, it's all about elevation.
Yeah, I mean, we can, we have it located near here. There's no reason physically that we couldn't pull it back some more. Whatever the sewer department requests, we have the ability to come back further back. So we could bring it further back. Right now, we have it relatively close. Just to give you gravity flow, but if you would like it further back. Again, realizing this is like a residential size, a E1 type ejector. This is not a big 4-inch from a pump station. It's a residential type flow.
And I'll make one comment regarding the picture of the building. And generally in a situation like that, we don't recommend or give guidance, but certainly if you wanted to be a good neighbor, people in the past have gone to the neighbors and given them a choice of 1, 2, 3, 4 buildings. What if, in the worst possible scenario, this is what you're going to get?
Thank you. If I can interject a little bit on the building, and I appreciate the board's history on that as well. But again, it is a very large building, but from North Maple Street, you are really seeing the end of the building. It doesn't really matter. This building came back to here, so you don't see very much of the building. Here, I do realize these people have a larger view.
Yeah.
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 Side
and we met it. Yes. Let's not
he
forget.
Right in our backyard.
On the north.
We live on that street.
We live on that street.
No, that one.
Yeah.
Yes. That one.
This
is where we all
exactly.
live.
All of us.
We all live right here.
Yes.
And it is treated here. And I respect, I would want to know what's in my backyard as well.
Yeah. So
just to put that in perspective, and then I think we're ready for public comments. At one point, we were hearing rumors of a potential commercial greenhouse complex for that site, which would have been something like 20 acres under glass, lit at night. And that would have been fully exempt under the agricultural exemption.
Okay. Audience questions? Yes, ma'am.
I have a question about trees
blockage. When a question is asked, they identify themselves and who they are.
Oh, sure.
That'd be helpful.
Melissa Alwee.
It's not going in the minutes.
Yeah.
107 Rocky Hill Road. We are located where the small box is on the top left, in the middle left. We've got that box. That's not our house, but we're further down to the left. So we're basically going to be looking directly at its roof, just like a few other people in this room. And so the green that is right there against the property edge, what is that? And is it like, it's wetland? So I did not hear anything about any type of barrier for noise or view for the surrounding homes. And I would hope that would be added to the plan.
Just to go over the plan again.
Like you did for Home Depot.
The green shaded area are designated wetlands that were located in the field, flagged and surveyed. So these are jurisdictional wetlands with a 35-foot no disturb and a 100-foot buffer zone. Any work within 100 foot, you have to get permission from the Conservation Commission. The same with these areas here. All light green are wetlands.
But the question is not the wetland. I'm talking about in your plan, adding in plants, trees that will block noise. And view from the homeowners on Rocky Hill Road, as well as the other side.
Right now, there are existing woods, and you know the area better than I do.
Yes.
We are not proposing at this point in time to plant trees. It is a big box, and to plant a tree.
Out of the year, there are no leaves on the trees.
Right.
On
so,
either side. Mm-hmm.
As far as noise goes, I just want to reiterate: this is a warehouse. And the loading dock, which again, we're not having semis back up there, it's a small van, would come in once a day.
Except for construction.
Yeah. Unload at this location twice a day, and everything takes place inside the building. It's a climate control building, they don't let noise and water and.
That triggered a comment. I agree that the noise from the use of the building will be minimal. Mm-hmm. However, I just thought of something, climate control. What does that mean?
Air conditioning system.
Air conditioning system.
What does it mean? What are your conditions? What is your plus or minus? What's your humidity level? How's it going to be set? How's it going to be controlled? Where's the AC condensers and all the rest going to be?
We can present the details. The climate conditions specified are 60 degrees within a few degrees tolerance.
60 degrees, okay.
And I'm losing my exact specification. It's 35% or 40% humidity within 3% humidity. The condenser design has some units on the east side of the of that shelving module, but it's it has low in out because of these are mainly materials that are rarely used, so that currently we have 600,000 volumes in the old strategic air command bunker, and we retrieve only a few thousand of them per year. So it's mainly holding for rare use, and so there's very limited traffic in and out of the space, and it's designed to have low heat loss, so low intake output, so well insulated, so it's not needing as much air conditioning as would a building that has a lot of airflow and traffic moving in and out.
Yeah, but what's the you're talking in excess? I'm going to guess of 400 tons of air conditioning. Ballpark, quick number in my mind. Numbers.
We can get you the number on that.
Okay.
It obviously varies depending on whether you filled it. When you fill it with books, it's more than half of the books.
I understand, but I'm just using a very, very rough cubic foot divided by a quick number to get a rough tonnage. And it's a very rough tonnage at best. I could be off, but I don't think I'm off by a whole lot. And the noise level of those things running on a 95-degree day at night, because you're climate controlled 24/7, 365, there is some noise concern, unless you're indoors with your condensers, which I can't imagine you would be.
And that's only one of five units that are subject to go in there.
Say what?
Well, they're
no, 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 no. I'm talking total building. That's my number for a total building.
For the 138,000.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, the question was brought up about that young lady over there about greenery. The elevation on top of that roof, and here's Rocky Hill Road, you'd have to have a 60 or 80 foot tree on the west side to hide that, yeah. Wouldn't you?
Yeah.
It's like... You're going to be looking at the roof of the building more than any frontage of the building.
Right.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Can I just make a clarification on the parking and the air conditioning? Because we keep hearing, and I'm sorry to say this, but, well, I'm not, actually. We keep not hearing about the fact that this is going to be a meeting area as well. You have 29 parking spaces, and there are, what, two rooms for meetings. So this is not... I think you should be honest about the fact that this is not going to be two little vans every day coming in and leaving. There's going to be a meeting schedule. There's going to be groups coming. 29 parking spaces with maximum 12 employees. So then you have
people on site.
We do the math.
How big are your meetings?
There are going to be meetings.
How big are your meeting rooms?
One for 15 and one for 20.
So there's going to be.
Okay, so you got 15 and 20. So you got meeting rooms for 15 and you got room for 40 people. I've only got 30 parking spaces plus employees. Correct?
Yes, if it were used at capacity.
It doesn't add up.
Right. It's not just a depository either.
And there are green things you can do on a roof that are out there.
To expect everybody to come in by a bus to your meeting rooms, to me, doesn't make sense. I mean, you've got to at least provide your parking for what you're going to have in your building.
That's right.
30 spaces.
How much were the sizes of the meeting rooms?
15 and 20.
15 and 20.
35 people.
And
A related point is, can North Maple take that kind of traffic in and out with the variety of people coming in and the trucks? And I won't even get into construction.
Construction aside...
That's a whole nother chapter.
Construction aside, I honestly, in that perspective, I don't think they're talking a lot of traffic on North Maple for 40 cars. You're not talking 40 cars an hour. They're going to come in, have a meeting, you're not going to have a constant thing. So I would think capacity-wise on North Maple, probably not a problem, but parking on site, seems to me they need more than 30 spaces.
I'm not too worried about the traffic on North Maple either. You know, for practical purposes, this is across the street from the industrial park, and zone lines are somewhat arbitrary, but certainly North Maple does serve an industrial park, and I don't think the incremental contribution of this is going to be major from a traffic perspective, but the point about parking is very helpful.
Somebody else? Yes, sir.
I'm Brian Alwizi from Rocky Hill Road, 107. I had a concern about the lighting also, since it's right in the backyard. It would be non-disruptive lighting. We already have all the lights from the mall. It's very disruptive.
Yes, sir.
Our proposal for security cameras is to use infrared cameras, and so no external lighting for security purposes on the outside of the building, only lighting in the parking areas that would be motion sensor activated, so that would only be on when there was vehicle traffic or
you don't have a night-long park. Basically, if nobody's there, then it'll be dark.
It'll be dark.
Except for some, probably, without a doubt, some security lights.
Well, we're arguing no security lights, so we'll have infrared cameras.
Oh, really?
And just have the parking areas illuminated when there's motion in those areas. And the entrance faces south, down towards the rest home. And so that light at the entrance through the windows that face south will be only slightly visible from the southeast for properties on North Maple, and otherwise that lighting, when there's occupancy in the building, wouldn't be visible from the Rocky Hill or from the northern properties.
It would be visible from North Maple, which is other people live there.
Right, to the southeast, yeah.
And the nursing home, too?
Somebody else?
Visible.
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
I'm concerned about the visual.
Name, please.
Virginia Kendall, 19 High Meadow Road.
Okay.
This building will be right behind my house, and I'm concerned about the visual impact plus my inability to ever sell my house. It will reduce the property value. Who wants to look at a warehouse in their backyard, which is exactly what I'd be seeing? I understood that in the beginning they only intended to build a 12,000 square foot building with the possibility of adding on later. I also understood that the primary users of this book depository will be the University of Massachusetts Smith College, temporarily while they rebuild their library, but it will be primarily UMass. So my question is, why can't it be built on university property, or why can't they use the library to store these books since they're converting to computers and getting rid of their books?
Mm-hmm. Okay, yes, sir.
The current depository collection, which is in the bunker on the notch on 116, and the primary use of the annex here is for a shared collection that the five college libraries contribute, remove all duplicates, and hold one copy of those materials that are infrequently used for occasional recall. So currently about half of what we hold is contributed by the university, and about half is contributed by the four colleges. The university plans to contribute more volumes. It has a larger collection to begin with,
had plans to contribute more, but to that shared collection, it is a shared collection for all five libraries, and there'll be additional contributions from the other campuses. So it's not a UMass facility, it's a five college facility for a shared holding that serves all five campuses.
I got a question of the gentleman. Are you planning to share any of those books with the host community?
The books are available, so it's divided between what would be called serials or journals-bound periodicals, which are held more cautiously, that can be checked out and used at any of the five libraries. The University of Massachusetts Library is publicly accessible, so anyone who wanted access to those materials could have them recalled to the university library for use there under librarian supervision. The books, on the other hand, so monographs, single issue items, are available for interlibrary loan under the
including the town of Hadley's library?
I'm sorry?
Including the town of Hadley's library?
I would have to check to be sure. I think the interlibrary loan includes loan to public libraries as well as academic libraries, but I have to check on that.
Yes, sir.
Just considering this.
Name, please.
Roland Mandler, 121 Rocky Hill Road. I'm probably the guy at 600 feet. If the natural heritage area is so close to this area that you can't provide screening around this building, then I would suggest this is the wrong plot for this building. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Negatives.
Yes, ma'am.
My name is Sharon Dombeck, and I don't own any of those houses, not on High Meadow, not on Rocky Hill. But we have an accepted offer at 7 High Meadow. And I knew nothing about this until yesterday when I happened to go to the town hall, and is it Dan, who's your assessor, told me about this. And it was not disclosed to me by my realtor. So we love that little house, and it's at 7 High Meadow. And I'll point to where it is, because I thought that Neil and I figured out exactly how far. I don't know if this makes any difference.
Over here, you want this one?
Yeah.
You're right about here.
Yeah.
Right in this bend in the road, this
right
big plot.
Right after the bend, just after the
bend. Unfortunately, ma'am, we can't see you.
Okay, right after the bend here. And, Neil, didn't we figure out that from the edge of this building to all the way up here, which there's people who are a lot closer. I don't think it's going to be neat. This sounds too... I feel sad that we have to turn down this house, but that was to the back door 600 feet, which is actually, I think, the length of the building. Two football fields?
The length of the building is 2 football fields, 625 yeah. feet.
So I don't know how that works, but that's what we figured out. Correct?
We tried to do it, not with the ruler, but with... Thumb measurements. So Mark has a ruler. He could tell us what that.
Sir, who found this property for you? Was it a local real estate agent?
Jackie Zusko. Probably knew nothing about it.
From that end of the ruler to the building is about 1,000 feet. From this point here to there is about 1,000 feet.
Mike, was your question to UMass or the five colleges about how they found it? Okay. So maybe you can answer that.
We had several successive realtors. We used Colbert Realtors for a while, and then Roy Johnson over here at Jones Realtors has been looking at us, and we had help from various civil planners who have been helping us.
Have they looked at any other properties for you besides this one?
About a dozen.
A thousand?
I say about a dozen.
Dozens.
Really?
In Northampton, Hatfield,
Tuberville, Hadley, and Amherst Pelham.
We were told that this one was picked because it was central.
It was also the only one that met the future growth needs. The first module, that's 125 feet wide, meets our 10-year projection of needs, but conservatively building a landlocked building that doesn't allow growth is where we are now with the facility.
Is there any reason that all five modules have to be in Hadley? Couldn't you spread the wealth around?
The staff.
I mean, it's state money, so it doesn't matter, you know?
No, it's not. It's private money.
Other question from somebody? Yes, ma'am, in the back.
Lindsay St. Lawrence, 116 Matthew Hill Road. We're right across from the field, so we get perfect. Two things. So the first building has the meeting rooms. Do the buildings 2, 3, 4, 5 have meeting rooms too?
No, they're just additional shelving.
Okay. And he mentioned something originally about 200 feet of frontage that they don't have. So does that not matter because they get...
It's a pre-existing lot. So, for that reason, they may need something from the Zoning Board of Appeals for an official finding, but they would be granted it. Yes, sir.
Jeff Moss, 11 High Meadow Road. I'm a little uncertain specifically about your jurisdiction in this. Is this a done deal, and you're going to strictly decide on what's built there, or do you have veto rights in this deal?
Maybe Mr. Dwyer can explain that again better when it's over, because he's going to give you a bit of a legal thing.
Yeah, it's very close to the line. It's we definitely have power to review this project. For want of, when we were thinking about the Dover Amendment, we changed our site plan approval bylaw to include projects of this sort, which is why we did site plan approval for the Wesley Methodist Church, which didn't otherwise wouldn't have gone in that site on North Maple. We are the reviewer, but the review standards are a lot narrower. In this, we don't really have authority to exercise, we can't really exercise our full authority under site plan approval. We can ask a lot more from the people who are here from Mountain Farms Mall than we can ask from this applicant. But we do have a couple of good points, mainly the it's interesting, the parking may make a difference because they may not have that much space that they have available for parking. The other thing is that bulk of a structure is something we can look at, and this, for the reason stated, is a very bulky structure. So, can we just say, no, we don't think this is a good idea? Probably not. Can we come up with some conditions that perhaps the applicant finds uneconomical to proceed? Maybe. We're not there yet. But you know, the point that was made about it, if this is too tight a site for natural heritage to allow trees to be planted, then maybe it's too tight a site for this project is a good point, because it is a big, ugly building as it now stands. And at the outset, I think it's pretty clear that nobody is liking what they're seeing.
Bill?
We may trigger some changes. So it's a long way around saying, you ask a very good question to which there is no clear answer.
At a point in the future, someone, perhaps you, are going to make a motion. And it'll be seconded, and we'll vote on it. How many votes are necessary to pass the motion?
This is a special permit. These are three special permits, which means you need a supermajority. Out of a five-member board, four out of the five must vote on the prevailing side.
Okay.
If it's anything less than four out of, let's say Bill makes a motion to approve this, four members must vote in favor of it. If he only gets three votes, the motion fails. And then the applicant has to decide, what does he do next? If they go to court and appeal the decision, the problem with that is any conditions that we could put on this for approval are gone. They now can virtually build what they show on these plans and anything that has been discussed here, they may decide they don't have to comply with. Is that correct?
It depends. The court would probably, if we had a detailed enough motion with reasonable conditions, the court might decide in their favor and send it back to us with the direction to issue the permit under those conditions.
Okay.
So that's why it's worth going through the exercise of doing the motion to approve it with conditions and then see how the vote turns out.
And then have good defined conditions of what we would like. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Has the land already been purchased? Could it be used for something else, or has it already been purchased by the five colleges?
It has not been purchased as far as I know. We were given a copy of the purchase and sale agreement. It has multiple contingencies, including satisfactory action from this board, from the Conservation Commission, from Natural Heritage. And since those conditions have not yet been satisfied, I'm assuming that they have not purchased it. At one point, the town had a right of first refusal under Chapter 61A. I think the time to exercise that right has expired by now. At one point, we did speak with the folks at Kestrel Land Trust about whether this was anything of interest to them, and the answer was no. This is not, for the reasons that Mark Darnold had said earlier, these aren't good soils. This is not prime farmland. That's why it's been sitting for quite a while. There really doesn't seem to be another great use for it.
Solar panels.
Well, that's where you get into natural heritage again.
A little bit of history of this property. It has seen a number of ideas, to Joe's point. Once upon a time, a subdivision was proposed there. I want to go, this goes back,
10 years.
Got to be 25 years ago, right?
Mm-hmm.
And somebody came, I don't even know if somebody came in as much as it was rumors to put a subdivision in.
Yeah.
And I know nothing was ever filed. We never saw real plans on it, just some theories, I guess, for lack of a term. And obviously, for the same reason everybody's talking about, you know, it's just not, it's a big piece of land, but when you get through with everything, it's not going to be very economical to put a lot of houses there because you're not going to put a lot of houses there. Same thing with greenhouses. You probably could put some greenhouses. That's probably one of the few things, along with a solar panel, that you could put on there and get away with. But even a solar, even a greenhouse, you're going to have to worry about those things getting a little bit wet. Solar panels, at least, could tolerate that within probably a bit more tolerance, but you know, it's not, there's not a lot of options on this property. Even farming it hasn't been farmed in years, if I'm correct.
About 4 or 5 years ago.
Okay.
Didn't back in the '80s that Chuck Holmes wanted to put over 55 housing there?
That was in back of his property. He did look at putting that. That's right. He looked at putting some. The man that built the nursing home did look at possibly, I think, buying this or the property behind him, I'm not 100% sure, to put some senior housing in before we got the senior housing bylaw. And at the time, we didn't have a senior housing bylaw. It wasn't allowed, kind of abandoned it, but it would probably run into a similar situation as a subdivision. It's a lot of land and not a lot of, you know, he's going to have basically a small area where he could really do something with. How much the wetlands have changed over the last 25, 30 years, I really have no idea.
They grew.
So. Yes, ma'am.
So I'm sorry, apologize, I didn't say my name before. So I'm Nancy Vanden Boyle, and I have the closest view right there onto the building. You know, I guess I want to say I see a reason for this building, but I think the place is the problem. And I think if it were closer to Route 9, it would be absorbed by all the other commercial buildings. For me, it seems like it's just in the wrong place. It's too close to a residential neighborhood where the houses are dwarf in comparison. I mean, I think any of you, if you saw this about to come to your neighborhood, you might really be quite upset about it.
The problem is that the Dover Amendment said that's nice, but it really doesn't matter.
Yeah.
That's the problem. I would recommend
we did talk about the bulk.
The bulk and the reasonable parking right now, from what information we've got tonight, they're not providing reasonable parking for possibly their needs. They're going to have to look at that and come back to us. That's one of the things, among other things, to come back with.
I'd call your elected representatives up and start talking to them.
Don't
email. Well, call.
Right. Could we not see a lowering of the height, you know? Could we not have more creative meetings about getting our input as a neighborhood in terms of lowering the height of the building? Maybe, you know,
you're still going to see it. It's down in a hole.
A lower building with plants
around
as a barrier may be a better.
That's a question. Why is the building 35 feet tall?
To get more books.
Books on the footprint.
So you're actually going to be stacking these books up in high rafts,
24 foot high shelving. Yes.
How do you get at it?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I have a question about previous use in the bunker. Mm-hmm. Did you guys use that with students, which is how you're getting this amendment, is by having this educational component through FCR? And so it's all one collection, and you're like, hey, let's use five colleges to consolidate this, and we can take this land and use it. I mean, it doesn't seem like the bunker was an educational facility. I think you're slapping this little educational component on it so you can make it work.
Mm-hmm. Well, Amherst College owned the bunker, so that's a little different.
So, you know, if you have five colleges that have a collection and they say, we don't have a space to put it all together, let's use this amendment that allows us to do whatever the hell we want, and we'll put it here. I'm Seth Morrow, 122 Rocky Hill Road. I'm right here. A beautiful view of that, by the way. You know, this is Berkshire Design Group. Is this going to be as lovely as the bioswales in front of Home Depot that you guys do? Mark's a good friend. Mark Linholt's a good friend of mine. But as a landscape architect and regional planner, I mean, this is foolish. And I think that you guys are taking advantage of a bunch of situations to get this in here. There's 146,000 square foot warehouse up in South Deerfield for sale. Currently, climate controlled loading docks. Why these options haven't been looked at. You say it's only going to have a couple people visit it, but you just said that it's a good central location that makes it efficient to get to. If it's not going to use very many people, what the hell does it matter where it is? I mean, we have Chicopee and Holyoke. You guys are supposed to be supporting this general Pioneer Valley. And we have two areas of town that could use your help more than anything. There are two areas of the valley that could use your help more than anything. You throw this in a greenfield. Like, I do brownfield redevelopment, and I'm constantly looking for projects that we can put on brownfields. And this flies in the face of everything I learned as a landscape architect. It's just disgusting. And that your organization would pursue this, it's an insult to the community, the environment. I mean, we use that trail every day. I look right down on that. I live in a 1,000-square-foot house. It's everything I own is put into that house. And it's just going to ruin my property value. And I'm not going to have anything. I've got two kids. a two-month-old, a two-and-a-half-month-old, or a two-and-a-half-year-old. My wife's a social worker. Like, you just destroyed every bit of equity I put into my house with this. Thank you very much. And think about it when you go back and meet with people. It just makes me sick.
Yes, sir.
I have a question for the representative of the five colleges. You must have expected this reception. You can't be surprised by what you're hearing, given what you're building. How do you feel about all this? How do you, really, what does your conscience tell you?
Are you addressing Neil?
I'm addressing the representative of five colleges.
Yeah, it's got nothing to do with a zoning hearing. If you want to answer that, that's fine, but it's up to you. If you don't want to answer that, you don't have to.
I think you should.
I'm happy to. So, I live in a property in Whiteley that looks down on Yankee Candle, and ever since Irene, I get to see Yankee Candle every night lit up. It's lit up when I go to bed, it's lit up when I wake up in the morning. So I understand this.
That's an industrial area. This is not. Sorry.
So, we are resolved to preserve in perpetuity 35 acres of this property that provide a substantial multi-hundred foot screen around the northern, western, and eastern sides of the property, limited only by what natural heritage will require us to do, which beyond what Conservation Commission requires regarding protecting wetlands, will include cultivating certain areas gently after the freeze has set in so that there is loose soil for the spadefoot toads, if they are there and they're not yet documented to be there, to be able to burrow down. They hibernate at 3 or 4 feet down in these kinds of soils. The wetland areas have, in part by current neighbors' choices, been pruned of trees and cleared for trails, not approved by the current owner. We are working with Natural Heritage to gain approval to maintain trails that we could then work with the neighbors to allow them to use under reasonable stipulations, which would include things like only daytime use, no motorized vehicles, whatever Natural Heritage would permit. But the wetland areas in particular haven't been farmed. The aerial photographs seem to suggest that serious farming hasn't taken place for about 7 years. If you look back at the aerial photographs, it's 6 or 7 years back to find farming. The wetlands were too wet to farm, and so there's substantial tree growth in some of those areas. And without Conservation Commission approval, we couldn't touch them anyway. So that's substantial growth, in some cases very thick, even without leaves, in other cases sparse. And so further planting is not possible in the wetlands, again, without Conservation Commission approval, and they won't approve big trees because that drains the wetlands of their water, so they approve things like dogwoods and elders, so small things. What can go in the farmable area where we're proposing to build can't cast shade on the areas where the spadefoot toad might want to burrow because they need a mix of sun and shade. So what you could plant as screening trees have to not destroy the habitat. That may forbid fir trees, and so you'd end up with some things, not others. We are working with Natural Heritage to gain as much approval as we can. You see the trail proposed that we're asking Natural Heritage to approve, and hope that they will, and look forward to working with the neighbors about access to that area, which has wonderful wildlife, birding opportunities. It's got bobcats and turkeys and deer and bear. It would be nice to preserve it all. It would actually be, in certain ways, less accessible to neighbor intervention. Neighbors have cut trees, neighbors have mown the trails. We'd have to do what natural heritage allows, and it would be somewhat less in the way of pruning and downing of trees, uprooting of rosebush and so forth. We'd have to do what natural heritage allows, what the Conservation Commission allows, and we plan to do that. And so to preserve 35 acres of natural space would be probably more assurance than the various development options that the board has discussed would necessarily provide. It feels to me as a good but imperfect compromise.
Okay. It is almost 9:30. We have other business to continue on as a planning board, so I am going to stop.
Could I ask one more question?
No. Unfortunately, no. Long enough. We already asked the legal point. Not that I'll, we will continue on, but we've got other things to discuss, and I don't want to drag this out anymore tonight. August 18th, is that a good day for you?
No.
By college?
Could it be sooner?
No.
I can't make it.
I can't either.
207 Russell.
Oh, August 18th.
That's going to be a big one in Andre. We're full on the 21st. We have Larry on the 4th. We dedicate Larry for the PVPC, because we're doing a new master plan, August 18th. So we're going to continue this hearing to August 18th.
Will it be just this topic for that
meeting? No, we will have the gentleman that applied and his wife for the accessory apartment at 7:15, and that other person that applies, those hearings will probably take 10 or 15 minutes. They're going to be short.
Okay.
So this one, if we schedule, we'll schedule it for 7:15, but I doubt we'll be starting much before 7:45. So there's no reason for you to get here 7:15. Okay.